So thank you guys all for coming out. Thank you to Leah, Ethan, Wendy, who I don't think is here, Laura, and 356 for hosting us. We usually hold this event at Gavin Brown's gallery in New York, so it's such a huge pleasure to do this here at 356. As Leah said, this is the fourth installment of Deadlines and Divine Distractions, which is quite simply a collection of letters, so it's really broadly defined. We like to say that the project is an expression of our ardent belief in letter writing as an art, and you'll see from the array of letters that we have collected this evening that anything goes. So we have faxes, complaint letters, letters to self, and WikiLeaks. Maybe, Pati, you just wanted to say one thing.
Yeah, we just want to thank everyone, of course, who contributed to this. And there are, of course, so many more amazing Los Angeles and West Coast writers. So we are hoping that we can do this again. And I'm just going to tell you the order of the readers. It's the first letter is going to be read and written by Miranda July. Then we have Kate Wolf, Rachel Kushner, Aram Moshayedi, Tom Keenan, Martine Syms, Jibz Cameron, Brontez Purnell, read by Adam Lindner. Sarah Lehrer-Graiwer couldn't come, unfortunately, because she's pregnant. And Dodie Bellamy and Kevin Killian couldn't make it up down here. And Brontez, of course, also because they're too far away from LA. And then, after Brontez's letter, we have Alexander Keefe, and then Sohrab Mohebbi, Silke Otto-Knapp, and then Francis Stark's faxes by read by Laura Owens.
And we have a website, and tomorrow all of these letters will go live. So, and the website URL is divinedistractions.com. So thank you all for coming, and to be continued. So we'll start with Miranda July.
I don't usually sit and read, but I think that makes sense.
You can also stand.
I didn't write it standing, so why would I read it standing, I guess? Okay. Dear M, when you called today, I think it was to wish me a happy birthday, but you got carried away with describing everything you were doing in Denver. As I listened, I resolved not to remind you, thinking if we can make it to the goodbyes and hang up without you remembering the reason you called, then that will be a sort of gift, the gift of being able to tell everyone you forgot to wish me a happy birthday. As the call drew to its end, I got nervously excited, hoping it wouldn't all be ruined at the last minute. But no, you never remembered. I've been able to add this story to the fact that we are all sick and no one gave me a present, quite a tasty soup of self-pity. I didn't really explain how sick I've been because of our long history of me trying to elicit comfort and you exploding with anxiety instead, sometimes even becoming perversely angry at me as you sense your own failure. For safety, I tucked myself neatly away into my perfectly self-created world. Let's take a moment to acknowledge how hard I've rocked that dynamic, how much I've managed to get out of it. Wow. And now, since it is still my birthday, let me indulge myself in this theoretical letter to a theoretical woman. On Saturday, I had a fever of 103, and I couldn't find anyone to help, so I was alone with Henry, who didn't really understand why I was such a bad playmate. The greatest challenge was taking the sheets out of the dryer and putting them on his bed. After each corner, I had to lay down and rest on the mattress, the room spinning and my body throbbing with aches. The whole process took me about 30 minutes. I kept telling myself, this is okay. It's just taking longer, but I'm doing it. That night, it seemed like my whole life had been this hard and always would be, but that it didn't matter. All that mattered was doing one thing after another until each thing was done. And in fact, this is true. My whole life is like that. One thing, one foot in front of the other. How could it be any other way, anyone's life? I had to act a bit with Henry. I made my voice reassuring to let him know everything was fine, even though I couldn't really stand up. The next day, he was sick too, and this was actually easier because he was less spirited. We listened to audio literature, Anne Hathaway reading The Wizard of Oz. If I ever meet her, I will have to commend her on this work. Her reading of the wizard himself was particularly off the wall, being far creepier than it was written. For example, Oz would be described as saying something meekly, and Anne would read it in the voice of a child molester riddled with perversion and only pretending to be meek. I wonder how much she got paid for this, was my reoccurring thought. I could never do it, not that anyone's asked me to, because I don't know how to read from my diaphragm. I can barely read out loud to Henry each night before my throat gets so tense it hurts. Just one of the many things I keep meaning to get on top of. But will I ever? I can only keep trying. Yours, of course, and love, of course, despite everything. Miranda.
Okay. This is Kate Wolf.
Oh. Yeah,
it's me. Okay, dear blank. I think I'm someone who could easily be crushed by my own nostalgia. A few weeks ago when I interviewed you about your former magazine, one of my questions was regarding the connection you had to other Los Angeles institutions of the late 1970s. I was thinking of CalArts and SciArc, of performance art, punk music, the not one but two media collectives who had offices on the same block as you in Venice, the beatniks from the Temple of Man, also in the neighborhood, reciting their poetry in their hot tub. I assumed you would say what an unbelievably rich time it was, but I was wrong. You said LA was a terrible wasteland then. You felt totally disconnected from everyone, and only now could you start to feel proud of what the city had become. It threw me, honestly, since I spent so much of my own time in a hazy, warm vision of the past. Related to this, I know I'm annoying to drive around with. It's all a lament about this or that ugly new development, and I recite the name of businesses I remember that are no longer open with a deep air of melancholy. I save shopping bags from shuttered record and bookstores. Any panel or book or exhibition that has something to do with the 1990s, when I was a teenager, I'm immediately interested. I think over and over of a block I used to work on in Los Feliz, the coffee shop I would go to there with the scraggly drug addict sitting outside all afternoon, of sometimes seeing the writer Dennis Cooper walk by, and the much older former Jewish Orthodox journalist who I went on some dates with and who had only three albums in his CD player, Doolittle and Loveless are the two I remember, which he told me he hadn't changed for years. There's something a little sick about this constant backtrack, yet also intoxicating, like stewing in my own delicious stench. Perhaps I collude things here, but I wonder how you're able to avoid thinking about the terrain of your youth without the same kind of longing confusion as me. It seems to have served you well, though there were hints that there might have been some bad blood between you and the other members of the magazine staff. I thought it was curious that you hadn't talked to people you'd worked so closely with in over 30 years, but then again, you might ask, why should you when something is over and done? Is there another option besides disavowal? I'm not a fool. The nauseating dog whistle of MAGA, for instance, enrages me. I recognize the danger of blank nostalgia. But in my own life, I still treasure without question the shimmer of any personal relic, whether in mental or physical form, and this is starting to be of some concern. What do you think? Warmly, Kate. Now we have Rachel Kushner.
I'm weirdly really nervous. And I think it's because I'm not reading a letter that I wrote. This is an incredibly personal letter that is a cherished document in my family. So it's just scary to share it with all of you. the original is so precious that I couldn't bring it. I just have a facsimile. The original is kept in a very secure place. Sometimes we even put it in a safe deposit box because it speaks of our history. Just very quickly, my family's first vehicle was a school bus that we lived in. And it had a wood stove in it, and we would park it on the street, and people got very upset with us if we parked our school bus in front of their houses. And several times people called the police on us, and once the tow truck already had the front of the bus connected. It was the middle of the night. We were sleeping in the bus, and my dad jumped up in his underwear and started the bus and drove away. Our next vehicle after that was this 1959 544 Volvo that my dad bought for $35. And we then had an apartment, and I was 11, and I started to become self-conscious of my family for being destitute and unconventional. But when we got this letter, everything changed for me. And I knew not to care ever again what other people thought of me or my family. We are sick and tired of your parking these ugly piles of junk in front of our homes. The streets are not used car lots. Cars are illegally parked after 24 hours. If you want to conduct a used car business, park your junk heaps in front of your own house, not ours. We're not going to allow you to park for weeks any longer. As soon as we see another broken down rattle trap in front, we will call the police at once. And if it continues, we plan to speak to our attorney about a court order. Used cars are to be kept, are to be sold in car lots, not in front of neighbors' homes. This has been going on far too long, and we will not put up with it any longer. J. and A. Doherty, 526 Hugo Street, San Francisco, California. Thanks.
This letter is by Aram Moshayedi.
Dear Aram, my name is Aram too. I still remember how this joke played out when we first met. Up until that point, the cover of your father's book had always appeared at the front of my mind whenever I would introduce myself to someone. My name is Aram. But I never imagined that I would one day say the same words to the book's namesake. You were quick to point out that your father, William Saroyan, simply liked the name and he chose it for you 6 years after My Name is Aram was published. I've come to learn that your father was not alone in his appreciation of the name, that Aram seems to be a favorite among Armenians. My Armenian dry cleaner, for instance, has been known to give me the occasional order of laundered shirts on the house. There are no bad Arams. You're like us, she says every time she hands the clothes over the counter. My sense has always been that her interest in my name has something to do with the Armenian genocide, and the search for commonality among Armenians bears in mind this fact. I've hardly experienced the same generosity from Iranians who, for the most part, can't be bothered. I'm not sure if you're aware, but Aram is more common as a girl's name in Iran, and its meaning is different. There was a time when the artist Hassan Khan borrowed my Uber account in Los Angeles, a city that you're also aware has a disproportionate number of Armenian drivers. Almost every time a car would come to collect him, he'd be asked, Aram, are you Armenian? It's a question I'm often asked, which I figured had something to do with my fair skin, but Hassan, an Armenian, that's a bit of a stretch. At age 10, I actually wanted to change my name to Eric as a way of better blending in at school. I didn't like having to explain the origin of my name or its pronunciation. Most often, people would call me Armin or Aaron, and the actual pronunciation would elude most who tried to grapple with it. In fact, in 2007, I consciously began to stress the long ah sounds in the name in order to avoid any possible misidentification. I don't know how successful I've been in this, and I still sometimes catch myself reverting back to the American pronunciation when I know that nobody is paying attention. I can actually date my friendships according to how my name sounds when someone says it. We've talked about this before, about how we both deal in different ways with the meaning and intended usage of Aram as opposed to Aram. Admittedly, I can never remember the pronunciation of the name Mara or Mara. I'm paralyzed by this fear every time I have to speak to or about Mara McCarthy or Mara McCarthy. I can never remember if she's Mara or Mara, something she's had to endure her entire life, I'm certain, as an Aram in reverse. There's a Leonard Cohen song called Love Calls You By Your Name that I think about every time I hear my name mispronounced. I've also noticed the way that your wife, Galen, says your name and how you reciprocate by writing poems dedicated to your love for one another. Perhaps it's not unlike how David Anton, no matter what the topic, always managed to affectionately mention Ellie in his talk poems. A passing statement in your poem, Lines from My Autobiography, dedicated to Galen, has always struck me. You make me feel Persian. What does that mean? Galen makes you feel Persian? Technically speaking, I'm half Persian, and I couldn't tell you what it feels like to be me. I think it's best that I wrap this up here. I've probably written too much already, but I will end by saying that it's not easy writing you a letter. I have so much respect for your command of language and the restraint of your words, as few or as many as there may be. You probably don't remember, but you once wrote me a three-sentence email about the first time you took LSD in 1965. I sat in awe of that email, its brevity, its brilliant construction, and I thought I might never be able to achieve the same in my own writing. Clearly, I'm still working at it, at finding my voice somewhere between the different personalities evoked by myself as Aram on the one hand and Aram on the other. So thank you for taking the time to read this. Yours, Aram.
Now we have Thomas Keenan.
I'm gonna read four short notes that my daughter, Claire, for whom Negar is a luminary. So this is Claire's present to Negar. Four short notes that she wrote to the Tooth Fairy. She was very suspicious of a creature that took teeth from small children. I think the first one was written in London, as you'll see. The Tooth Fairy's name was M, E-M-M-E. So you can sort of sound that out. Dear M, I would like to keep all my teeth. This one is my sixth. How many teeth have you lost? All of them? Is your real name Emily? Do not take this note, please. Please give me pounds, maybe more than pence. Love, Claire. Dear M, here is my 12th lost tooth. I am very glad to lose this one. It has been loose for a while. I hope you can write back. Love, Claire. Hello, M. I lost my first molar. I am awaiting the next. I hope you're doing good. How is the tooth business? Glad to know you are coming. Claire. Hello, here is my tooth. You can take it tonight. I think the next is a molar.
Our next reader is Martine Syms.
Dear R, I finally read the book you sent. It's filled with terrible advice. I agree with her on the cruelty of the silent treatment. But once you're no longer in a relationship, once the bond has been broken, some people should be shunned. Do not engage. The other half of me was like, am I shunning C right now? What is my responsibility to another? I just wanted to bang. They didn't. Now I have to text back or I'm an asshole? Boo. It's 2017. I love saying the year like it means something. It's 2017. Side note, put on DJ Dion's Let Me Bang. Original, obviously, because hashtag mood. This is my current anthem. Wish you were here chair dancing with me. Also, the part where she talks about trying to befriend the black woman at the residency, oh my God, I would have punched her too. I literally wrote, no, in the margin. I was so disturbed by this book, I had to talk about it in therapy. Next time, I want something with zero traces of self-help. I'm instituting a moratorium on self-improvement literature. I'm still trying to become my best me or whatever, but I'm done reading about it. It's like when I only ate Soylent for 3 months. I'm ready to put my body on the line. V keeps telling me to read the Ferrante books. I refuse. Just because every beautiful woman in New York has it on their coffee table doesn't make it good. And the covers, Jesus Christ, does she know me at all? Right, it's intentional. I'm still only reading women because down with the fucking patriarchy. Anyway, miss you. Side note, can you believe C texted me that? What a fucking psycho. I think they meant to type I in brackets, miss in brackets, the attention you in brackets gave me. Maybe my best self is a cold hard bitch. Now playing Lil' Kim, love, queen bitch, supreme bitch, M.
Next reader is Jibz Cameron.
All right, this is my regular voice, just so you know. Dearest myself, it was lovely to see you over the spring holiday, albeit far too short a visit. Let me get straight to the point and say plainly, I love you. I love you from the very depths of my being. This may come as a surprise to you since I rarely show my affections, but my care for you is immeasurable. You alone have brought me to this place. It is for you alone I think and plan. Please allow me to come to thee with open arms. Let us meld ourselves into a great spiral of sensual happiness, together on this earth and beyond into the next. Oh, look, a letter came back. Fantastic. Dear self, thank you most kindly for your letter. While your words were charming and effectual, alas, they fell on deaf ears. I can only hope to be a woman ready for such a claim to joy. It is with regret that I must reject your advances. I must apologize for perhaps displaying wants towards an intimacy with you that I cannot in reality sustain. You will be forever in the back corners of my thoughts, but I shall remain thus until God sees otherwise. Sincerely, myself. Dear self, I have just been notified that my other self has posted a letter of rejection to you in response to your glorious pronouncement of love and
devotion to my second self. I have to say that self replied far too hastily. She is still but a child and acts impulsively, the whims of feelings which rule her body and soul. I would like to propose that we get together and discuss a partnership that is sustainable and steady, devoted and caring. Yours, other self. Dear other self, self, while I'm delighted to receive this change of heart, I fear that the relationship you propose sounds a little trifle uneventful to me and might cause an atrophy of the heart and, dare I say, entire spirit. May I suggest we all hop on a conference call and discuss? I have an account with freeconferencecall.com, and I can just send out invites via email, and we can just get a conversation going, right? Yeah, because it's really hard with all the back and forth and blah, blah, blah. Okay, awesome.
Next reading is by Bronte Purnell, and Adam Linder is stepping in because Bronte is not here.
Dear Bradford Nordine, I know you think I'm totally full of shit, but I still think we should get married. I know exactly what you're thinking. You're thinking, every time two poor people get married, God kills a baby angel in fury. My friend Zach taught me that. I don't care about baby angels. You have a bubble butt. I'm into that. That's cool. Let me also say, I have not been faithful. When I called you on Valentine's Day, you were in LA and I was in Oakland. I went out that night. I was drunk. I was lonely. I had sex with an Ethiopian teenager in the basement of an abandoned house. He lived with his brother, and he was closeted. It's been raining like hell up here. I mean, it's Northern California, right? And so I scooped the basement out, because I was certain there were homeless dudes, probs in there. I felt like Nancy Drew with my phone flashlight. No such homeless people were there, so we had the full run. I bottomed. Then I met this Latino daddy at his house. Then this weed grower guy from Mendocino came over. He was hot. He says he's up north 7 months out of the year growing weed, and when he comes off the mountain, he's horny and can't wait to get fucked. His butthole was clean but still smelled like wine. It turned me on. I think he was high. Anyway, I have had other infidelities too. Can you find it in your heart to forgive me? I was talking to my aunt who lives in Harlem the other day, and she is a hilarious New Yorker who has no concept of California geographic regions and California geographic separations. After 15 years of explaining it to her, she still thinks that Oakland and LA are 10 minutes apart. I say to her, no, Oakland is across the bay from San Francisco. I say San Francisco slowly so it can sink in. Underneath it all, I know she still doesn't understand, because she'll say shit like, aren't you down the street from LA? Or she'll say, what's the difference between the cities? And I'm like, LA versus the bay is like Athens versus Sparta. But I do think there are ways the two cities take turns being Athens and Sparta. We have a rainy season and you guys have traffic. I don't trip out about it, it's cool. The last thing I'll say on the subject is that you come in, sorry. The last thing I'll say on the subject is that how come in the movie Poetic Justice, it takes Janet Jackson, Tupac, and Regina King, and whoever else that other guy is, 3 days to get from LA to Oakland? No one ever clocks that shit, but I ain't sleeping on it. That shit ain't right. So, I'm about to premiere this new dance piece in New York at New York Live Arts. It's called Chronic, A Dance About Marijuana. It's gonna be dope, Lol, get it? Anyway, I can't wait to talk. I can't wait to walk right up to Bill T. Jones and ask if I can borrow a 20. OMG. What if he actually gives it to me? Anyway, Bradford, call me when you're feeling lonely, okay? 510-435-8310. Bronte, kiss hug.
Next reading is by Alexander Keefe.
Just a short letter. It's like a letter to a should have been long lost frenemy. I'm just gonna start with that. A, but I found you out. Spotted your little spurt of hummingbird shite fall like a surrender scene. Or was that supposed to be an offering? Don't walk on the ridgetops, old chum. Don't piss in the wind. That's what I've been told. Anda chua tote dan. The blind or the rat, the spoiled or the grain. Just my luck on the radio this morning, I caught the tail end of the worst. Elton John and Kiki D's bicentennial bad faith anthem, Don't Go Breaking My Heart. The song is a fucking curse, you know? The Kiki D jinx, they called it. After 6 number one singles, Elton John didn't have another hit for 21 years. It took Candle in the Wind, a discount dirge stitched together in 1997 from finger bones and fish hooks. A lyric grown like shrooms in Walmart dirt. Feeding on the phony and the dead, outlasting its creator and someday feeding on him too, no doubt. What a jinx-busting black magic, though. An eternal celebrity corpse fucking requiem and with it fame. Stygian fame. Dank, with an expanded contemporary photo collection as a bonus. Better seats, fewer forced appearances alongside members of the band Styx. And for Kiki D, only that colossal truth. Nothing ever leads to anything, nothing ever adds up to anything, and nothing ever goes anywhere. The gold you seek turns to shit. Abandon your investments and leave. Some syncopations just don't add up to fucking jazz. And anyway, there never was such a thing as affectionate pastiche. I don't care what carte blanche says. Blue-eyed is bullshit. Either this is all sha-na-na or none of it is. I can't keep this up, so let's have it out once and for all. Either that or it's 8 and all good numbers to you, buddy, from the bottom of my heart. Jate hue kete ho kayama ko melenge. What a relief. Here I thought it was today. Tub tuck, nobody knows it. Kisses and candlesticks, you're only, only A.
Next letter is from Sohrab Mohebbi.
This is not a letter that I wrote. When I was in around 2001, 2002, a British lady started to frequent a lot of parties that I would go to in Tehran. And a lot of my friends, that include myself, we all liked her. I wrote a piece for Bidoun with her. It was called Hair is for Headbanging, and it was about the metal scene in Iran. But all along, there were certain rumors flying around about a British lady in Iran speaking perfect Farsi. So anyway, when the WikiLeaks released the emails of Hillary Clinton, the first name that I searched obviously was Coco. And lo and behold, there were some results. So now I'm gonna read one of these emails and just a little bit of, if you guys are not familiar with the Iranian politics beyond Westwood, Khamenei as the supreme leader of Iran. The Revolutionary Guards are this other army, which was founded by Khomeini after he kind of had doubts about the loyalty of the army that was Shah's army. Montazeri and Saneh, there were kind of more progressive ayatollahs. Montazeri died under kind of house arrest. Diane Reynolds is the email code name for Chelsea Clinton. Hillary Clinton is not the president of the United States now. So, unclassified U.S. Department of State case number F-2014-20439, document number C-0577-3078, date 8/31/2015, release in part B6, from Diane Reynolds, dreynolds@clintonemail.com, to Hillary Clinton, HROD17@clintonemail.com. Subject, from Coco. Sent, January 6, 2010, 7:06 a.m. Subject, interesting, re-Iran. Okay, Coco. I still think the Western press is optimistic about Khamenei and the Revolutionary Guards' weaknesses. But moves like that against Montazeri and Sanei, and inflation running unofficially at 25%, confirmed by furious downtown Tehran friends quoting tomato prices, may finally push a broader tranche of society to join what has been a middle-class protest until now. The big problem with the protest is that it doesn't have a credible leader, or stated ideals, but it certainly terrified those in power. Predictions are for nutters in this situation, but I would doubt that Khamenei has the stomach for civil war, and there must be some deals cooking. It's a tricky one for the West over whom to support, because no deal will be clean. To be continued, ... All love, Coco. Diane, I've always wanted to go to Qom, and Iran too, admittedly. As you know, more for the far history than recent, I confess. I can't sort out whether I want to go more or less now through because of recent turmoil, promise, discontent. Maybe want and sense are merely opposing forces. If only I could find an appropriate Jane Austen quote. I'm still very sad we missed your 30th, and we'll miss your official fund launch. Hopefully, we can celebrate with you soon. Hillary, please print. Thank you.
Next reader is Silke Otto-Knapp.
Dear Elizabeth Bishop, I could never be a writer. You've wrote about 100 poems in your life. I figure that's about 2 every year between the ages of 20 and 67. I find myself distracted so much of the time. The only exception might be when I'm in my studio. I don't have internet there, so I listen to NPR, even if the programs start to repeat after a while. Some time ago, I listened to an interview with a writer who had just published a new book on your life. I began with a recording of you reading the poem at the fish houses. I noticed the specificity of your introduction. You called it a Nova Scotian poem about the east coast of Nova Scotia, south of Halifax. You stopped short of naming an actual place, and naturally, I wonder where exactly you had in mind. Nova Scotia is part of the Maritimes on the east coast of Canada, along with New Brunswick and Prince Edward Island. For a few years now, I have been visiting nearby Newfoundland, So when I listened to your description of the fish houses, a connection began to appear between my studio in Los Angeles, this far-flung region on the North Atlantic, you reading in 1977 and me making paintings today in 2017. Cold, dark, deep, and absolutely clear. The clear, gray, icy water. Back behind us, the dignified tall fir begin, bluish, associating with their shadows, a million Christmas trees stand waiting for Christmas. The water seems suspended above the rounded gray and blue-gray stones. I have seen it over and over, the same sea, the same slightly indifferently swinging above the stones, icily free above the stones and then the world. If you should dip your hand in, your wrist would ache immediately. Your bones would begin to ache and your hands would burn as if the water were a transmutation of fire that feeds on stones and burns with a dark gray flame. If you tasted it, it would first taste bitter, then briny, then surely burn your tongue. It is like what we imagine knowledge to be. Dark, salt, clear, moving, utterly free, drawn from the cold hard mouth of the world, derived from the rocky breast forever, flowing and drawn, and since our knowledge is historical, flowing and flown. You read that poem with a flat voice that sounded both impersonal and intimate at once. It was casual, but each word was articulated with care and precision. The poem has the same quality. I like the way you describe how the water meets the stones. Looking closely shapes your thoughts and choice of words. Sometimes I think of a particular radio program or audiobook when I return to work on a painting. I'm sure the painting's been influenced by it, but I can't seem to make out how or any of the details. It's frustrating, like trying to recall a dream after laying awake for a while. Most of the program following the poem was about newly accessible letters you had written your partner Alice, some close friends, and your analyst. The appearance of these letters had convinced the author that it was time to write a biography. Apparently, they reveal details of your private life, complicated relationships and emotions that you seem to keep outside of your work, in spite of the fashion for confessional poetry among your peers in the 60s. The writer explained that at first she felt the need to protect you from such an intrusion into your private life, but later decided that the same apprehensions didn't seem to apply to reading and making public the intimate letters of male writers. Personally, I prefer reading letters and biographies of women artists and feel slightly embarrassed, but how keen I am to know about their lives, as if I could apply this information to my own in some way. I would want to ask you about your influences. Were you ever interested in, like, say, Virginia Woolf and Vanessa Bell, Florence Stettheimer, or Gertrude Stein? Or did you find them too bourgeois and European when you decided to travel to South America in the 1950s? Would you have known the work of younger artists based in New York, such as, you know, Yvonne Rainer or Joan Jonas, in the 1960s and 70s? You grew up in Canada and later moved from New York to Key West, then spent 15 years in Brazil before moving back to the US for the last years of your life. Oceans both north and south and people's lives close to them are at the center of your work. A moose crossing the street, observed from a bus, a waiting room in a doctor's office, a cold morning, a lightning storm at night, a conversation, scenes observed and described with a formality that lets me hold on to them for long after reading the poem. I think this might be a good point to end my letter. I didn't even mention your paintings of street scenes and interiors. Next time I want to talk to you about your use of color. Also, your paintings don't ever seem to have figures in them. I wonder why is that? Why that is.
The last reading is by Laura Owens, and there are a series of faxes written to her by Frances Stark.
Yeah, these are from 97. Hi, Laura. I had my notebook, my private notebook, with me in bed while watching Raymond's Beatles video. I was thinking the private notebook pencil combination would make me feel more at ease. And then I got to reading some things, and I came across this passage where I first tried to articulate the housewife sensation. But as you'll see, it didn't go very far. But I thought I'd share it with you, and it has something to do with Christy Turlington. Actually, Helena Christensen in this case. I think that's her name. And since I'm procrastinating anyway, I thought this would be an allowable distraction since maybe it has something to do with our box. was thinking, had sharp sensation akin to insight, but the thought stayed fuzzy like a dream, and it had to do with describing myself as a housewife. But how the minor and fractured exertions in my banal domestic schedule are made into big deals, insofar as I am some kind of cultural agent, how there is this micro-reversal of consumer to producer, no big shocker theoretically, but I would say it's harder to figure me, aesthetically, into that equation because my materials aren't linked to the sphere I mention. But the totally minor, by comparison, crafty efforts afford me a lifestyle that is strangely of both worlds. As if I were an intellectual, but my actions' choices say otherwise. It's more like I am the wife of myself. I want to put a picture of a fashion model on my refrigerator and do leg lifts suggested in the same mag, repetitions of 15, and then hope to work out my obsessions with turn-of-the-century Vienna in 5 easy minutes a week. Oh, on Housewife, continued, April 7th, made a short list in the line at the bank today. That is the most I accomplished. This is a good example of that freaky disproportionate ratio I want to describe in the housewifish analogy. The ratio of nothing to something when interiority implodes into a gift that seems like an escape rather than a limitation. Two or three phrases for $2 or $3, two or three pets in two or three collars, two or three seconds of 2 or 3 hours, two or three aphids, two or three flowers, two or three ladies or two or three bugs, two or three tugs on two or three rugs, two or three ideas per 2 to 3 head, 2 to 3 times you wish you were dead. Two or three bees in one of our bonnets, 'cause two or three pictures to launch into sonnets.